Tonight, will you win the low-speed lottery? Also, all about Apple announcement, 3D-printed guns, and being a geek in paradise. Padre's Corner is up next.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Padre's Corner is provided by Cashfly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is Padre's Corner, episode 28, recorded March 13th, 2015. Drones in Paradise. Hello, and welcome to a special Friday the 13th edition of Padre's Corner. I'm Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit. Padre SJ in the Twit TV chat room. Padre's Corner is a show where we put you into the mind of a Jesuit priest to see if you come out sane on the other side. A while back, Lisa and Leo got together and they said, you know what? We want a show that's just for our fans, just for the audience, just for the members of the Twit TV army. Those stories that fall through the cracks that maybe aren't really tech or fall into a weird place. That's what we do here on Padre's Corner. And let's get right to it. Now, normally this is the time where I talk about some freaking science or some freaking engineering. But they say that when you become too predictable, that's the end of the relationship. So I'm going to do something a little different. This is a segment I'm calling A Bit Off. Now, we all kind of hate traffic cameras, don't we? I mean, even those people who are the most civic-minded folks that you might imagine don't really like the idea of some impersonal hunk of metal and plastic being able to hand us a ticket, especially if those tickets can be crazy expensive. Hey, drivers, when you think of speed cameras, there are probably a few unmentionable words that come to mind, and it's exactly for those reasons. You know, if we can get pulled over by a police officer or a highway patrolman, we understand that. We get it. You know, we did wrong. We may be annoyed, but yeah, you got me fair and square. But to be caught by a speed camera, to be caught by a traffic camera, there's just something wrong. There's a reason why a common pastime in the United Kingdom is to set speed cameras on fire with a stack of rubber tires. Now, some call them intrusive, abusive, and more of a safety hazard than the speeders that they catch. In fact, recently there's been a spate of arguments from people who are saying that traffic cameras have become a nuisance because the companies that set them up pull down a big chunk of change by essentially tricking you into going fast. Well, there's a different way to think of traffic cameras. You see, I know that most of us are annoyed to be caught by a camera, unless, of course, you live in Sweden. You see, in a test of positive reinforcement instead of slapped with a robot stick and therefore making you stop your speeding, Stockholm, Sweden is testing an idea for making followers of a traffic limit, well, rewarded. That's right. If your vehicle is caught by a speed camera going at or under the posted speed limit, then you're automatically entered into a lottery. And here's the best part. The prizes, well, they don't come out of a coffer. They don't come out of taxes. They come out of the tickets from people who were speeding in the same cameras. That's right, folks. You can now sit in your lane at the speed limit with the smug smile on your face, knowing that the people zooming past you as they get caught by those traffic cameras might be giving you an extra C-bill at the end of the month. Now, this is more than just an experiment in whether or not positive reinforcement can work. Stockholm wants to reward people for driving safely, and they want to build a better sense of ownership. In other words, these are your roads. These are your resources. This is your land. What are you going to do to protect it? So the next time you get caught by a speed camera, who knows? Maybe it's time for you to enjoy a little bit of the posh life. Now, when we come back, it's my favorite part of every Padre's Corner, and that's when we get to introduce our guest. But right now, I thought might be a good time for us to take a moment to reflect and look at the tech. You probably know that I'm a big fan of quadcopters. I like building them. It fits the engineering mind that I have. I like putting things together. I like figuring out how they work. And quadcopters, or drones as some people are going to call them, hit in a big, big way. Well, one of the very first builds I did for know-how was an FPV 250 from Hobby King, a nice little kit that included pretty much everything you need to get up and flying
with a quadcopter. So without further ado, let's take a look at the FPV 250.
So you've mastered your quad trainer and are ready to try something more challenging, but you want a multi-rotor that's more hands-on with the hardware. If that's you, then you're the kind of geek who may be interested in the spec FPV 250 from Hobby King. Priced at under $110, the FPV 250 is an almost ready-to-fly 250-class quadcopter kit. Out of the box, you'll find a one-piece glass fiber body with detachable landing struts, four Multistar 1704 motors, a set of 5x3x3 propellers, four Afro version 3 12-amp electronic speed controllers, a power distribution harness, 1,000 mAh lithium poly battery, and a first-person view camera mount. To complete the kit, you'll need to purchase a transmitter and a receiver, a flight controller, a set of servo leads, and a battery charger. All told, the FPV 250 can be fully operational and in the air for less than $160. The hardware is actually pretty good for a beginner's kit. The frame is nearly indestructible, the motors are forgiving, but still powerful for such a small craft, and the kit requires no soldering to get it in the air. There will be some who question buying a kit for $110 that is incomplete, but it's exactly because it's incomplete that makes the FPV 250 so attractive. This kit gives you almost all the pieces you need to build the craft, while also giving you enough design and engineering leeway to customize it to your liking. Think of the FPV 250 as a hovering Lego kit. One thing that the kit does lack are instructions. Any instructions. A complete novice opening the box will probably like all the shiny things, and it's not too difficult to figure out where the pieces physically go, but wiring the electronics can be nerve-wracking when reversing a single connection can blow the entire craft, and there are no instructions to tell you how to hook it up. Yeah. The lack of instructions is almost unforgivable, but luckily, Twit TV did a complete step-by-step guide to assembling the FPV 250 in Know-How Episode 122. Everything from mounting the motors to installing and configuring the flight controller to wiring the power systems and tuning the craft. So while I'm not super happy that Hobby King built a beginner's kit that is unfriendly for beginners, it's not a deal killer. Okay, so that's what's in the box and not in the box. The question is, how does it fly? In a word, brilliant. The FPV 250 can be completely gentle and forgiving for the novice pilot, but agile enough to appease experienced pilots when the flight controller settings are turned up. A generous but not crazy thrust-to-weight ratio means that the craft behaves predictably in flight, but also has some decent zip when you want to hit the gas and drop it into manual mode. It's also very resistant to crash damage. But then again, why am I talking? Let's just watch it go.
I got to say, I absolutely enjoyed building that kit, the FPV 250 from Hobby King. Not only does it really teach you about the basic components of any multirotor, a quadcopter, septicopter, whatever it's going to be, but it's also pretty much indestructible. That frame has handled some ferocious crashes. About the only thing you're going to snap are props, and if you get unlucky, you might snap a motor shaft or two. But it's a really good way to get into the hobby, especially if you've got someone younger or someone who doesn't know if they quite have the technical aptitude. If you are looking for a way to get into quadcopters, if maybe you're thinking about designing one of your own, start with a kit like that. It's going to cost you about $100 plus, a radio and a battery charger and a battery. So you could do the entire process for under $150. And trust me, you're going to love it when you start flying. Now, it's appropriate that we ran that video because my guest for the show actually lives where I shot most of it. That's right. I was in Hawaii over the break. And I welcome to the show Mr. Ryan Ozawa. He is a journalist, a tech head, and a man from the islands. Ryan, thank you very much for coming on the Padre's Corner.
Aloha and namaste, Padre. How are you doing?
I'm doing just fine. Thank you very much. Now, there's going to be people, and we always get these people, so don't worry. It's who are going to say, wait a minute, who's this guy? You know, he's not someone we've seen on the TWiT TV network before. But you are someone who I follow in the real world. I've seen your work. I've seen your broadcasts. I've seen what you write. I've seen what you follow. And you're a geek, sir. You're definitely a geek. Can you establish some of your bona fides to the members of Padre's Corner?
Well, first of all, I am a longtime TWiT fan and following Leo and have always aspired to, you know, be a little Leo in my day. So watching all of the shows, I was on Forecast some time ago when that was a TWiT show, seen all the shows come and go. Here in Hawaii, I've just basically been involved in technology probably since the late elementary school days, getting into dial-up BBSs. I got to the point where I was running one in my house, so I loved the modem sound effect because, you know, that kind of reminds me of my youth. And for me, the passion has always been in using technology to connect people. So bulletin board systems did that. And then I got really heavy into Usenet. And then, you know, all these things before the web where people would be able to connect. But certainly when the internet exploded, that's when my head exploded. And it's been history ever since.
You know, it's funny because as you're talking about your experiences in the early days, especially going back to the BBSs, because that was a life-changing experience. I say this sincerely because before then I was building computers, but they were just computers. They wouldn't even network to each other. I could have two computers next to each other, and the only way I could exchange data was putting it onto like a 360K floppy disk and moving it from one to the other.
8-inch floppies.
Yeah. I got love. And remember the trick, because you could always punch a hole and make them double-sided and, you know, increase 720 or maybe even do that to one of the smaller, the 3.5-inch floppies and get yourself a meg and a half. I mean, it was amazing. But
yeah, I mean, it's like our kids just they get tired of hearing us talk like this, I'm sure, because it's always been in their lives. But we're constantly having our minds blown. I started the first Macintosh-based BBS in Honolulu. So that was kind of fun because if you thought you were weird being a BBS user, you were even weirder being a Mac-using BBS user.
You know, I think there definitely is a generational gap here because, I'm sorry, older guys like us, remember the days when the internet wasn't just apps and the World Wide Web. You know, we remember things like Usenet and user groups, and that was our primary mode of exchanging information. And I don't know. I kind of waxed nostalgic for it. I guess that's true for anyone who grew up in those days, right?
Yeah, well, you know, Native Hawaiians, when they meet each other, they kind of recite their ancestry and their history to establish where those connections are. And I think for us, that's kind of how geeks smell each other out when they meet, is like, where did you jump into the stream? Where did you join this path to the ocean? Now we're all swimming out here in the sea, but we came by different rivers. My daughter can't believe that you had to use the telephone line. I mean, we don't even have a telephone in the house, so I'm not sure she can even appreciate that, to connect with people, and you had to, one person at a time could connect to the system. I mean, that also blew her mind, too.
Yeah, we've had a couple of guests who did their first interconnections with BBSs, and I remember what multiplayer games look like on BBSs. It was, you would log in, you would make your move for the day, and then maybe come back a day or two later. And that was, again, that was mind-shattering that you could do that with someone who was in a different city, a different state, a different country. And again, we take it for granted now. That's what you do on the internet, right? But back then, it was uncharted waters. And so much of what we do today came from that generation who first networked two computers together and then realized I could do this with everything.
I really look forward to what, I really look forward to what might blow the minds of my kids. You know, since all of this stuff just comes with life, I think the bar is set very high for them to be as excited as we are.
Right. Ryan, I want to take a step back. So, yeah, everyone knows you're a geek now, and that's all you need to do to be on Padre's Corner. But I lived on the islands for a while.
Being
a techie on the islands is not a natural thing. I mean, Brian Chi is, and he has his place, and he developed his own lab, and that was his niche, and he was very good at it. But you and I know that if you grow up on the islands, there's a limitation of what you can really do. Everything seems to be related to the tourism industry. There's not a whole lot of opportunity. And when I look at technology and people who had a passion for technology, most of them move elsewhere. And so when I find someone who stayed on the islands, I always want to know why that happened. How did you find tech? Why did you stay in tech? And why did you stay in Hawaii doing tech?
Well, you know, I like to say that I came to technology in the back of a police car. And that was because when I was much younger, I got into a lot of trouble with my friends and periodically might run afoul of the law. And then what would happen is if they didn't take you all the way in, they took me to the Boys and Girls Club. And that happened to be where there was a little laboratory with Commodore computers. And these Commodores, if you wanted to save your work, you saved them to audio tape, cassette tape. So you would record and then play back your programs to load them. But that's kind of how I came to it. I think if it wasn't for discovering those computers, I might be in a, shall we say, a different line of work today. But I'm happy that I kind of turned to the geek side very young. I know what you mean, though, because Hawaii suffers from what we call here the brain drain. Opportunities aren't as great. The tech industry is growing, but it's small. As you may pick up periodically from this conversation, bandwidth is a challenge. I had to come to a co-working space called the Box Jelly for reasonable bandwidth, but even it'll be constrained here because it's not as widely available. There's no fiber. There's no Google fiber coming to Hawaii anytime soon. But why did I stay? I mean, I think that's a question my wife asks quite a bit. She's from Florida. She moved around a lot as a kid, and she can definitely see that some of the opportunities, some of the exciting things aren't happening here. But in that case, it's definitely my upbringing is definitely my family. I love the people and I love the energy. I love the spirit here. And I didn't know that you had history here, Padre. And I think that probably comes through now that I think about it in your outlook, in your energy, in your friendliness. You have the aloha spirit deep within.
Well, when I first moved to the islands, everyone thought I was Hawaiian. And I'm like, no, no, I know why you do. I know why you think that, but no. But you know, it's funny because where I lived was literally 45 steps from Brian's lab. And I had a key for his lab, so I could go in late at night and mess around with his equipment. I mean, we had known each other before that. So it was actually one of the things that I did to stay current. And for him, he's had to work really, really hard to build up the contacts and build up the network so that he could get people to come to the islands. He could get companies to send him equipment.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
What's it? I mean, he calls himself the geek in paradise. You're obviously also a geek in paradise. What do you have to do to be able to cover tech from the middle of the Pacific Ocean?
Well, I think, as you probably know, it's not as big of a challenge today as it was then. And I kind of like being on this side of Silicon Valley where things happen in the morning there, but it's very early here, so we have more time to process things, I think. Thanks to the internet, I think the geographic isolation has not been as much of an issue. I like what you talk about, you know, hanging out in Brian's lab. I guess that might be at the University of Hawaii. That's another way that I found my way to technology. My friend's dad was library professor at UH, and we spent a lot of time in the basement of Hamilton Library using his super secret access to the internet back then, which was very text-based, you know, browsing the web or whatever the web was with Gopher Space and all of that and exploring that way. So no longer do we need to climb through basements to have access to these things. I would imagine that postage is still difficult to get gadgets to send for review for Brian. But I think other than that, access to the information and access to the news is just as easy here as it would be in Zimbabwe.
Both Brian and I, when we were both living on the island at the same time, I use this system a few times. I know he did, but we have addresses here on the mainland, and so a lot of times we would have them ship product there, and then it would be shipped in bulk over to the islands. Just because you're right, a lot of companies say Hawaii. There's no testing labs in Hawaii, or why would I send product? What are you doing? And, let me ask you this. You talked about Hamilton Library. I actually got into Hawaii. I lived right off the campus. Most people thought our property was part of the campus, but it was just above it. Mm. It was right after the big flood. Do you remember the flood they had in Hamilton Library? It must have been.
Oh, yes, I do.
Yeah, early 2000s. What had happened was the creek that runs through Manoa, it dammed itself because of all the debris, and the water actually flooded over the banks into the library. And there's stories of students who were down in the basement, and suddenly there's water pouring through the windows. One of Brian's students actually had to smash out a window in order to get them out because it was just coming right down the stairs. They couldn't go up the stairs. And then there's a corollary to that, which is why I'm talking about this. While I was there, they had to move all their rare books upstairs because the rare book collection had been in the basement of Hamilton Library. And these, we're talking about irreplaceable texts, hundreds and hundreds of years. I think there was one that was like a 1,000-year-old text, and they got soaked. So they created a special room up on the top of the library because they figured we never want to get caught in a flood again, with an air conditioning, a high industrial strength air conditioner to pull all the moisture out. My first year there, they had a cave-in of the roof during a big storm, and all those rare texts got wet again. And it's funny because people just kind of said, it's Hawaii. You know, don't get too mad. Things like this happen.
Yeah, we have an affection for those things. I mean, we jokingly, not in an insulting way, say that, you know, it's almost a developing country out here. On the one hand, we have really good practice with natural disasters. We have not just flooding and hurricanes, but we have volcanoes and we have other threats, landslides that are common. But you would think that given that history, we'd be better or more prepared for them. I mean, the joke here right now, for example, is that the Pacific Tsunami Warning Center is in a tsunami zone. And that we have the most critical backups for our state government in the basement of a building below sea level. So, I think it's because we're not used to basements. Maybe that's it. But absolutely, I think it makes life interesting. But certainly if you're thinking about starting a business or doing a tech company, there's a lot of preparation that you're going to have to do and probably an adjustment of your expectations given what Hawaii can support out of the box.
Right. And that's why you've got geeks like Brian, who has been busy in bringing fiber to the island. I mean, that's kind of his passion. He's taking fiber that has been discarded by some of the big telcos because they're upgrading, and he's using it to make rings around the island so at least the islands have high-speed internet with each other, and then hopefully to get a trans-Pacific link so that he can, you know, finally get some decent speed at decent prices. I got to ask you this. Again, as someone who grew up on the island, how do I put this? There's always been a little bit of disbelief that anyone who lives on the islands could have a serious career in anything other than holding a luau. I mean, and we know that's I have no better way to say it, right? They say, "Oh, you live on an island, so your job is to be on vacation 24/7."
Right.
You must run up into that. I mean, in your job as a journalist and especially in your job as a tech reporter, you must have people who just think, well, you can't be serious because you're wearing a Hawaiian shirt.
Well, you know, that's I can see that for sure. And, you know, business attire in Honolulu is an aloha shirt. But when you wear this on the mainland, people think that guy is going to a party. I can see that. I mean, we've had some really great people come out of Hawaii. I mean, you may or may not include the president of our country in that list, but I do. You may know Guy Kawasaki, who had an early history with Apple. You have Eric Nakagawa, who was the person who made lolcats a million-dollar business.
Becky Worley.
Becky Worley. Yeah. Oh, Fantastic. Yeah. So there's a lot of we are good at growing many things, not just pineapples, but I would say talented, friendly, and happy people. But I hear what you're saying. I mean, I'm on Twitter as Hawaii, and that makes life very interesting because people, without knowing it or not, sometimes direct rhetorical questions at me, and I'm perfectly happy to answer. Whether why do you have interstate highways, or can I visit without a passport? Do you take American money? I used to joke that I should say that I'd be happy to exchange their U.S. dollars for Hawaiian money and then just send them a bag of sand for $20. I could probably get rich off that. It's definitely something that you have to face and deal with. But I mean, I was just listening to your conversation with Dr. ONJJ Stone, and being from Hawaii is another one of those conversation starters. It's one of those things that is novel and unique and interesting enough that somebody wants to know more about it. And even if they do start with the luau, it can lead to deeper conversations pretty quickly.
Right. I have to ask you this. Your Twitter page, you have the name at Hawaii. Now, what user were you, like user 5 or 6, that you were able to get the name Hawaii?
No, it was November of that first year, so I was actually pretty late. I think it was Robert Scoble, for many of us, who was the person who said, try it out. So that's why I joined. Most of my local friends joined around then, too. What was good about being early, of course, is you can get the username that you really, really want. That's always a challenge. I've always done that. I mean, I've got Hawaii on Instagram and YouTube and Flickr and all these other services. I'm a little obsessive about it.
Well, yeah, you're supposed to be. Go figure. Ryan, another question here. You did mention a little bit that you were big into like Usenet, you were big into Gopher, you were big into all those early services. Was there something before the rise of the World Wide Web that you were particularly proud of building or being part of?
Before the web, I mean, again, my background is journalism. It took me 9 years to get my journalism degree, but I still got it. When I first got into technology, there weren't websites, let alone news websites. So there was someone at the University of Hawaii who, because there's an enormous community of expats, people who left Hawaii to go elsewhere, they always wanted to know what was happening in Hawaii. So what I started doing was writing recaps of local news that you could just quickly log on and get via Gopher Space. And although that sounds really obscure now, people were really into it back then. So I kind of started the first news service for Hawaii before the web. It was on Gopher Space and then Usenet and then finally on a web page.
Yeah, yeah. There's something else I do want to touch on a little briefly here is, do you share something with Brian Chi in that both of you
both
have...
handsome. No, well, he's handsome.
Yeah. Yes, I would never insult a guest. Of course you are. No, but aside from that, you're also both trying to bring science and technology to the island in a big way. His thing right now is the Mini Maker Fair. So he's really been pushing it. He wants to have a lot of really good demonstrations. He wants to inspire the next generation of builders on the islands. I believe one of the things that he told me is, I don't want our younger Hawaiians to believe that the only thing you can do is either work in the tourism industry or get educated and then move elsewhere. I want them to understand that we're fostering an environment of learning here. And so that's what Maker is about. And I know that you've been involved with that as well. And your blog, your Hawaii blog, is actually, it's dedicated to bringing science and showing what kind of engineering is going on in the islands. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, certainly I would say my passion that is most visible is my interest in evangelizing, advocating, bringing to the surface all of the interesting science, technology, engineering, and math, the STEM things that are happening in Hawaii. That's sort of the basis of a radio show that I do on Hawaii Public Radio with my good friend and longtime geek partner, Bert Lum. So every Wednesday, we have a live radio show on public radio, and we talk geeky things, and it can be as obscure as dark matter and space and things like that, or as as fun as robotics and the Maker Faire. And we recently started doing segments on the morning television news to do the exact same thing. So it's definitely something that I like to do, is to let everyday people in Hawaii or people who don't even live here know that these kind of things are happening here. The Maker Faire is excellent. We're moving into our second one now, an official mini Maker Faire. Of course, we have several maker spaces on different islands, Kauai makers. There's a maker space on Maui. There's a maker space on the Big Island. So we kind of want to bring that to light. My personal event, I do an event every year, seventh year coming up, called the Geek Meet. And it was my attempt to get geeks outside, because as you can tell, we could probably use more sun and more fresh air. So it's actually a geek event that happens at a beach. And we still have people in stormtrooper outfits, and they're very hot, but they're very nice to come out. And we have rocketry people and drone flyers and 3D printers and solar companies and anything with science, technology, engineering, and math. We bring them together, but also get them a little sunburned. So that's fun.
So a lot of people don't believe me when I tell them that, you know, in the years that I lived in Hawaii, that I actually didn't go to the beach that much. They had an image of me being there every day. Like, oh, well, if I lived on the islands, I'd be surfing all the time. And they don't believe me when I say, well, look, I surfed maybe a dozen times, and I was never very good at it. And I, you know, I would go to the beach on special occasions, but most of the time I would just relax at home and enjoy the Manoa Creek. When you live in a vacation hotspot, I guess people don't believe that you actually do work.
And I think that's probably true for people in Florida or in other resort areas. But unfortunately, in all of these areas, there are schlubs that sit in a cubicle and never see the sun. And I would be one of those people. I actually have a day job at a wonderful real estate data company called Hawaii Information Service. Not only do they help me pay the bills, which we all have to do, but they do give me the freedom to be a little more geeky, do my radio show, my TV things. But unfortunately, and one thing that we always try to convey when a lot of people are sitting in the coldest winter in history again, you know, in Boston or something, and they're saying, oh, I wish I could move to Hawaii. There are challenges with that. Costs of living is very high. Average price of housing is high. The percentage of your income that goes to just paying for rent and food and gas, one of the highest in the countries. So yes, you can live here and still never spend time at the beach. I can go a long time without seeing the sun because I like to leave before dark to beat the traffic, and I get home after dark. So there are workaday people here. There are hardworking people. There is the visitor industry. Those people work very hard. Military is also big here. Where there are jobs, there are people that are trying to earn a paycheck rather than relaxing on the beach. I can't remember right now the last time I was at the beach.
Okay, Ryan, let's go ahead and start talking a little bit about the tech that we both cover. One of these stories that just broke actually this morning, very interesting for people who are looking at flying quadcopters or drones or whatever you're going to call them. I really don't get caught up in that distinction. There was a story that came out about how the FAA cracked down on a relaxational flyer. So someone who enjoyed putting his drone up in the air. He flew it in a bunch of places with a bunch of people. And the FAA has basically sent him a cease and desist letter saying, you put them up on YouTube where ads are placed against your video, and therefore your flying was actually commercial use. And as a commercial use, you can't do it because you're not licensed, and therefore stop it. Now, this has got a lot of people up in a tizzy because that's kind of what people do. You take video with your drone and then you put it on YouTube, and maybe you make a couple of cents slapping some monetization on it, but it's not a whole lot. In fact, here at TWiT, we do a series where we teach people how to fly drones. So necessarily, we're going to have footage of drones flying. And now, you know, we're kind of wondering, wait a minute, does this mean the FAA is going to tell us that we can't educate people about quadcopters? Because, there's monetization involved. Have you covered this story at all? Have you had a chance to take a look at it?
We've had almost annual drone shows on our radio show. It's something that I am passionate about. I even started a website called HawaiiDrones.com, trying to stay on top of it. But I'm also a big chicken, so I actually don't own one. So I don't really feel too qualified to talk about it. I will tell you, though, that because I love them and because my day job is in real estate, it's something that is hotly discussed because, yes, everybody sees the strong business opportunities here. I think in the YouTube story case, I think the FAA did, I don't know if they walked it back, but they basically said that might have been a misunderstanding of the rules, but it is still going to be a sensitive area in terms of people making money with it. I mean, so TWiT does a drone show. You help people manufacture them, put them together, assemble them. You're not specifically charging me to watch those videos, but TWiT is a commercial enterprise. I mean, would that run afoul of the law? People in real estate are taking drone videos of their property. My dad sold his house, and I helped, or actually my good friend Mike helped make a video with a drone of that property. He doesn't charge for that service to try to stay out of that hole, but it is a very tricky area to be, for sure.
Right. You know, it's partially because the rules that the FAA is trying to apply were built for passenger planes. I mean, that's FAA. That's what they do. And so it's very simple. If you're accepting money to fly, then you're commercial. But as you know, a lot of people, most people who are flying drones, even the ones who take a lot of video, we're not taking the video because we're going to sell it. We might put it someplace, and who knows, maybe it goes viral and I make a couple of bucks off of it. In fact, that's happened to me on some of my videos. But defining that as commercial just because it might somewhere be used for a profit stream, it seems kind of silly. And as you said, the FAA does seem to be walking back on that decision. In fact, I believe the exact wording was they had a safety inspector who was a little too zealous in applying this and got kind of goofed. But also, and I think this is even more troubling than the original story, this was all triggered because somebody who was a competitor of the person who put the video up complained to the FAA. So it's almost as if, so if someone doesn't like me, they can just make a complaint to the FAA, and the FAA becomes what, their attack dog.
I mean, I think anybody who's lived in a neighborhood with an association and neighbors who don't like them probably know that story. That even happens in real estate, of course. Realtors are competitive with each other, so they'll turn each other in rather than actually getting caught. I do have a lot of sympathy for the FAA, though, because government organizations can't move at the speed of innovation. That is just not going to be in their capabilities. I'm happy to say that Hawaii is one of the specific FAA-designated test areas for trying to figure out both policy, practice, and ways that drones can be useful. There's research here because we have an active lava flow that's threatening a neighborhood on the Big Island. Just last week, we had a hiker, a young man who got lost on a hike. And in addition to actual, you know, professional rescue people, there were people in the drone community coming together to try to use their drones to find this lost person. So we in Hawaii are very aware of the applications that this can have, not just for money, but for other reasons. But unfortunately, yes, the FAA is kind of behind the times, basically by design of government agencies.
That's actually a really good point, because it's too easy to pile on to government agencies and say, oh, you're so stupid, you don't get it, you don't understand. Especially when the FAA, it looked like they were hinting that you would have to get a pilot's license to fly a drone. People were just looking at them going, well, how outdated can you be? But I think you're absolutely right. You do have to cut the agency a little bit of slack, because if you took a balanced look at it, and I'm looking at it from the view of an enthusiast, so I like flying these things. I like building my own quadcopters. I like the freedom that comes from me being able to fly it responsibly. I look at a lot of the videos on YouTube and I say, you're doing anything but flying it irresponsibly. In fact, a few weeks ago, we had a video filmed from a drone in downtown Honolulu. It was, yes, of course, a DJI drone that smacked into the side of a building, not once, but twice. Nothing happened to the flyer. In fact, the flyer got his drone back because the wonderful person who found it said, does this belong to anybody? You know, spirit of Hawaii, spirit of aloha.
The aloha spirit.
Exactly. Yeah. But I look at that and I go, I don't want that.
Padre, the local drone community is very close and very passionate, but there are, you know, you see things like that and you go, this is why we can't have nice things. And I know many drone pilots. There are even members of model aircraft associations, larger organizations with certifications and good relationships with the FAA. And there are people that basically say, we cannot wait for FAA regulation. Maybe not a pilot's license, but maybe a test, maybe a certificate. They are actually okay with that because, you know, the same day that we're trying to get excited about the potential for drones to save lives with a lava flow, you turn on the TV and a drone drunk government employee crashes one on the grounds of the White House. So maybe, you know, I think there are people who are actually open to having some level of some criteria to be able to pilot one of these.
And I think another problem that we see there is there are some of those quadcopters. Like we took a look at a SEMA X5. It's a $50 quadcopter.
I have that one. I love it.
It's a toy. That is a toy. I mean, you can fly it outside, but it's a toy. And if you crash it into anything, it's not going to destroy it. It's that I feel comfortable with anyone flying and crashing continuously. But then you start to move up. And even the FPV 250 that I showed off in the tech segment, that thing, I would not want to be hovering over a crowd of people when it lost power. I would not want that to smash into the windshield of a car because someone was shooting over a freeway. And even though it's easy to say, well, you know, flyers got to use common sense. Like when I fly, I fly using one simple rule, which is I assume that at any point, the thing is just going to fall out of the air for any number of reasons. It's going to go out of control and it's going to nosedive. And so I do things like not flying over 400 feet. I do things like not flying over a crowd. I do things like making sure that I'm not surrounded by obstacles that could make my craft go out of control. But not everybody does that. And because not everybody does that, you almost have to say, okay, it's time for some entity to step in and say, you can do this if you're a hobbyist, but if you want to fly over a beach, you got to be a commercial. Or you can...
Well, but you look at the... I mean, there's other good communities like the ham radio community. I got my ham license and there are bad actors. But it's largely, I think, a very good self-correcting, self-policing community. I've been at events. I mean, we have some very large events. Honolulu Marathon, Lantern Floating coming up at Magic Island. You're going to see drone videos of that for sure. But other drone pilots seek each other out. And when someone sees someone flying low over the crowd or hovering over a street or doing something that they know is dangerous. I mean, they don't go and, you know, knock the controls out of their hand. They say, hey, dude, you know, I'm with this club. You should come fly out with us. We can teach you some things, but what you're doing right now isn't cool. The problem being is that it's getting easier and easier to get them. So they might be, you know, increasing in numbers faster than this community can really bring everybody in. But that community spirit is something that I think is helping a lot because I've definitely seen at a recent fun run here, there were two drones flying and there was a woman singing and the drone tried to get like a shot right in her face. And the other drone pilot who was staying at a distance just went to him and said, you know, knock that off. And it was distracting to other people. Don't disrupt the ceremony, stuff like that. I thought that was a good interaction.
I'm glad that you brought the ham community into it because we've got a very strong, very loyal, very devout ham community here at Twit TV. And you're right. They're very good at self-policing. I mean, they know the rules. They know that there's always a regulatory body that they can call to for help. But that's how you do an enthusiast community right. You have everyone looking out for everybody else. And like you said, it's all about how you ask. There's these guys I'm going to have on Padre's Corner. They do a show called Flight Test, which I think it's fantastic. Mm-hmm. So on YouTube, they get thousands of views per episode. They're very good at what they do. And they talked about the difference of reaching out to enthusiasts. Specifically, they were at a flight line, and they had an official come at them and just basically yell at them and yell at other people for not flying the way that they wanted them to fly. And they said, wait a minute, no. You do this in the spirit of an enthusiast. You go out and say, hey, man, you know, I noticed you're having trouble. Why don't you fly with us for a while? We'll show you how to fly. Or let us show you how to safely handle that device. You get a much better result than saying, hey, you're an idiot. You should never pick up the controller again.
Right. I think that's been really nice. I mean, I'm sure there are going to be the people who are almost aggressively going against the community or going against norms. When that video of someone crashing their drone twice, by the way, it hit the condo in Honolulu, bounced off and tumbled, but then it self-corrected, regained its stability, but because it was still in return to home mode, crashed into the building a second time. I mean, when that made the local news, the chatter among the people was, were they trying to get a picture inside someone's window, trying to violate their privacy? There was recently a story on KITV here that somebody made the case that someone would use drones to case your property to rob it, because everyone knows that's somehow better than just walking or, you know, looking over a fence. there are going to be people who are going to go out of their way to be jerks, and you can't help them. But like in the ham community, like now in the UAV, UAS community, I think that most of the people you see, they're going to help each other be the best representatives of their hobby that they can be.
Right. And I think that's pretty much all we can hope for. Let's go ahead and move on to another story. I don't want to spend too much time with drones because there's members of the Twit Army who are so tired of me talking about drones and quadcopters. Let's talk about something that, you know what, it hasn't been in the press. It hasn't been in the news. No one is talking about it. So I think we could have a good time just spending some time. And that's the Apple Watch. Okay, this has not been in the news at all.
Obscure story?
It's a very, very rare story. Apple, of course, released their new watch. I want to get your view on it. I have my own view, and I'm a little jaded and I'm a little tainted. I understand. Okay. I understand that people are kind of excited. So, of course, everyone knows this, but I'm going to say it anyways. We know that there's going to be three different versions. There's a sport version that starts at $349, goes up to $399 between the 38 and the 42 millimeter version. You've got the Apple Watch version, which starts at $549, goes up to $599 between the two sizes, and then can go all the way up to $1,100 depending on what kind of band you've got. And then for those people for whom money is no object and sense is far to be found, they've got the Apple Watch Edition. This is the players only. This is the one you keep the price tag on so that people see how much you paid for it. It's 24 karat gold. It starts at $10,000 and goes up. So, Mr. Journalist, Mr. Tech Blogger, Mr. Official Representative of everything that is the spirit of Aloha. I made up that last part.
Oh, no, now we're doomed.
Tell me what you feel about the Apple Watch.
Well, first of all, I want to say that I think Twit has done a great job in covering it. I've listened to every show about it, and I don't think that we're going to be able to say anything that someone else hasn't, but I'm happy to share my opinion. I am a Pebble wearer and became a Pebble wearer once the Apple Watch rumors started coming out. I wanted to see if there was a use case here at all or if we were all deluding ourselves for it. With the caveat that the Apple Watch is solving first world problems and with the understanding that it's certainly not something for everybody. I mean, I'm surprised at how many people are genuinely offended that the Apple Watch exists. I mean, it's okay that it's not for you, but you don't need to be mad about it. I don't get mad about your favorite set of golf clubs or anything. You know, you have what you love and I have what I love. Let's all be friends. But with that said, thanks to the Pebble, I'm going to be there April 10th, looking at the watch, trying to decide which size, because I think that although it's a very unique use case because it is tied to your phone, at least in this first iteration, I see use and benefit from my Pebble watch, but everything that I've thought to myself, I wish this Pebble could do more, I think that the Apple Watch will do. My primary concern is that most of the reviews have pointed out that it's a little more complicated than they thought, and when I first saw the picture of the Apple Watch with all of those little icons on it, I immediately said, oh, that's going to be a problem. I think that might actually be true. I don't think it's going to be as intuitive as people hoped, but getting your notifications, as tiny of a thing as that is, getting the time, extending and controlling apps that you already use, I think that it's worth it. I'm definitely going to get one.
Oh, by the way, I'm sorry for that last pick that just showed up on screen. There was someone in the chat room who was wondering about drones and pizza, and the TriCaster has a mind of its own.
That sounds like a great combination to me.
No, but Ryan, so much though that I like. First, and this has to go out absolutely at the front, I don't think anyone should be offended that these things exist, right? I mean, even if you're not an Apple lover, Apple fanboy, and I'm not an Apple fanboy. I use some of their products, but I'm not in their ecosystem. You have to admit that they've really driven forward that particular market of consumer electronics, and that's always a good thing. Competition is great, and you're absolutely right. You know, I'm not going to get an Apple Watch, but I'm not going to get an Apple Watch because I hate Apple and I think it should disappear. It's because I use mostly Windows and Android devices, so it's not really going to help me. And I don't feel the need to have something on my wrist yet. But, you know, again, that's a personal choice, right?
Yeah, I mean, I have to say I'm bi. I carry a Nexus 5. I like both sides. I think the Moto 360 is fantastic. I like that the ones that are going for the round watch face. I mean, I will covet that when I see another smartwatch wearer that might not be wearing the Apple Watch. So, I mean, there's the Apple tax. There's the fact that it's even like that $10,000 model that is not really going to be for anybody except someone who needs to demonstrate that they can spend $10,000. I mean, not for us. Totally understand. But I like my Apple gadgets, and I think that after I wore my Pebble and found that I was actually using my phone less, which is ironic because these things extend to the phone, but I'm actually using my phone less and getting things right at my wrist, just glanceably getting my things, I've actually felt that there's a benefit to that. Because when you get a notification and you say, oh, what did my wife text me? It's hard when you're looking at your phone not to go, oh, but there's a little thing on the Facebook icon. There's a little thing on the Slack icon. Let's check that out. Next thing you know, half an hour is gone. When you have just the most important information coming to you with that you can look at without any effort, I think you're more productive. You're less likely to go down that rabbit hole. So I can see the case, but I like that there's competition. I like that there's 7 or 8 great Android Wear watches, and you know, Sony and some others are coming up with their own as well. Let everyone have the watch they want.
Yeah, downstairs, my co-host for Know How, Brian Burnett, Cranky Hippo, he actually has a Moto 360, I believe. And it's nice, actually, and he uses it a lot. So he has figured out a use for it. And I look at it every once in a while, and I'm impressed with what he could do. It's not for me. Maybe at some point there will be a wearable device that I'm gonna look at and say, that makes sense. And I'm actually kind of excited. Now, Beef in the chat room, he has an interesting point. He says he's not offended that these high-end Apple Watches exist. He thinks it's just disgusting that some people have that much money to waste. I can't really argue against that. I mean,
for the 10,000 one, I can see that. I mean, and yeah. You know, you back when the Tesla was $80,000, you would say, are you buying that because it's the cutting edge technology and pushing the bounds of automotive industry, or are you just buying it because it costs that much and it looks that good? I think we're at that point where we're at the first Tesla version of the Apple phone, Apple Watch. But I think as with anything, it'll slowly become more accessible, more understandable. There'll be other options. But just like coming out with the new MacBook with no ports, I think that they're annoying some people, but they're kind of setting a flag in the sand and saying this is where we think this technology is going.
Right. Let's move from Apple to Apple. There was another announcement at that event. And actually, this one's interesting. They announced a new MacBook. And some people promptly lost their stuff. And other people promptly said, what is wrong with Apple? And other people said, I'm going to get one. And actually, the CEO of the company, Lisa Laporte, did say, look, as soon as it's available, I'm going to get it. It looks perfect for me. I like the size. I like the functionality. I don't need a whole lot of ports. So that's a person who would love it. We have other people who are saying, wait a minute, it has one USB-C port. This is ridiculous. What's wrong with Apple? And right now there's this actually a pretty good viral video going around YouTube of someone took a, have you seen this one yet? Someone took a Spanish TV show, like a talk show, and they titled it with basically the engineer explaining why they have such a weird looking working MacBook. We'll show it after the show. But
all right, I'll look for that.
So the big thing is that it's a 12-inch. It's got an edge-to-edge keyboard. It's got Retina display, a lot of the things that you would expect. It's got a Force Touch trackpad, which allows you to feel clicks. It's got 2304 by 1440 resolution. It's 13.1 millimeters thick. Not the thinnest notebook ever, but still pretty dang thin. It uses Intel's new Core M, which puts it somewhere between an Atom processor and like an i5 or so. And 9 hours of browsing, 10 hours of playback. I know you're a Mac user, so I'll ask you, where does this fall in your hierarchy of Mac products? I mean, so you've got Air, and then you've got MacBook, and then you've got MacBook Pro. This is one of those that kind of bends the genres a little bit because it seems to be dipping into the Air genre.
Yeah, well, I mean, I remember when the iPad came out and people said, well, this is coming between the laptop and the desktop. And now you have this MacBook Air that's kind of coming between the tablet and the laptop. It's not for me. But again, I kind of like the conversation, the smart conversations, at least, that Apple is starting with it. You know, the very first MacBook Air, I had a coworker that got it, and it was horrible. It was sexy, but it was horrible. But all of the trade-offs that they made to make that happen eventually paid off in what is now a very successful line of MacBook Air. So I think that, you know, buying version one, you're going to know that, that it's going to be a little tough for you, but they have to start somewhere. They have to make that step, and I'm glad that they did. And in fact, one thing that I'm surprised people are mad about is the one USB-C port when, oh my God, Apple is going to be making a power connector that is not proprietary. I mean, I think that should be something to cheer. And I think that just like the Chromebook Pixel, which I also covet, the fact that they're basically saying is that computing can be completely mobile and wireless and you shouldn't necessarily have to plug anything into it. I think that that's what the new MacBook is doing. The fact that it's lighter than the first iPad is amazing to me, that they can get that larger screen and a smaller body. Even the keyboard, which I thought couldn't get any cooler or better for Apple's. I think that that's exciting. But what I really want to try on this new MacBook is the new Taptic, trackpad. The reviews of that have made me really curious about how they can give you the sense of having pressure sensitivity and feeling different depths as you push down and push harder and push harder. Like you feel different clicks, like you're pushing further and further, but nothing is actually going, nothing is being depressed. I mean, all of these technologies, I'm glad they're putting in there. Maybe I'll be interested in the MacBook 2017, but I'm glad they started today.
Fantastic. Let's move on to something that's not a drone. And it's not an Apple product. And specifically, something that is near and dear to a lot of our audience's heart, that's 3D printers. There was a lot of promise with 3D printers, this whole idea of you being able to build something or prototype something quickly. And there's been a wrinkle. Specifically, there's been a wrinkle with people who are trying to ship 3D printers that can do somewhat dangerous things. There was a story here talking about how FedEx and UPS are refusing to ship the Ghost Runner. The Ghost Runner, a 3D printer, which is a milling machine that's capable of manufacturing some gun parts that would traditionally have identification numbers, and in this case, wouldn't. So you could create an untraceable gun. There's a brouhaha going over this because it's not illegal to ship something like this. It's not illegal to make those parts because home builders have been making those parts forever, but we're getting into this murky part of the law. Talk about the government trying to catch up with innovation, where they used to be able to count on major manufacturers making these things, and now you could have some homeowner on a corner somewhere churning out a bunch of items that some might seem dangerous. What's your take?
Well, just like when we talked about drones and we're talking about these 3D printers, everything is a tool and they can be used for good or evil. We in Hawaii, and I'm sure in many areas, people tried to pass laws to ban drones, and it was for privacy and things. And I said, well, are you going to ban long sticks at the end of which you can put a camera? And this kind of attempt to stop is also sort of trying to fight an uphill battle that I don't think can be won. I mean, you could 3D print a spoon and then kill someone with a spoon if you really wanted to. So it's not so much that it's a weapon or that it could be a weapon, because that's true of almost anything you can put in the mail. Just like with the FAA, but I think in this case much less reasonably, I can imagine some bureaucrat somewhere is trying to stem this tide, because yes, when eventually 3D printers are built into every house the same way a dishwasher is, you can imagine that once one neighborhood kid says, hey, I'm going to print a gun, and then all of his friends press the print button and print a gun, that's a nightmare scenario that would keep any lawmaker up at night. But I don't think that this is going to go very far. I think they were trying to send the message that this is dangerous, but I don't think that they can succeed.
Yeah, and honestly, I hope they don't. I'm not a gun nut, but I'm also not an anti-gun person. My brother is actually really big into firearms. He's taught me how to fire them safely. I know how to handle them safely. And I understand that, yeah, crazy people get guns and crazy people get all sorts of things that hurt other people. I wish people would use more common sense, and I wish there wouldn't be this knee-jerk reaction of every time there's a move to make something safer, everyone feels that the world's coming to an end. And you can apply that for anything. You can apply that for 3D printing of guns, for drones, for people who are absolutely losing their minds over the net neutrality decision. But with 3D printing, I find this particularly interesting because Have you ever read the Daniel Suarez series, Demon and Freedom?
I have not, but I will after this.
You should. We had him on Twit TV not too long ago, and he picked up on something that's sort of been in the underground culture for a while, and it's the termination of the 10,000-mile-long supply chain. And the basic theory is that we've built a society, a global society, that's tied to this idea that things are manufactured elsewhere, and then we purchase them, and we bring them here, and when they break, we buy more. And that keeps the global engine running. There is a group, they're part anarchists and part engineers and part geeks. It's part everyone. It's part all of us who are saying, wouldn't it be amazing if we got to the point where everything you needed, every part for every machine, for every device that you use, could be manufactured within the limits of the city? Essentially, that's going back to how we used to be way before technology exploded. And what that would do to society, what kind of transformative effect it would have if suddenly you didn't have to contact China to manufacture something that you wanted for something that you're building.
Well, Padre, as you probably knew when you lived here, yes. Our physical isolation makes these conversations very common. And during 9/11, I was just talking to a young a fifth grader who interviewed me and my radio co-host last night or Wednesday night. And of course, he hadn't lived through 9/11. And when the plane stopped flying, there was panic in Hawaii because we had plugged into this wonderful global just-in-time inventory economy where our Costco stores and our supermarkets had no big warehouse somewhere. Things were just coming in on planes and on boats exactly when we wanted to have them. So when the disruption of that terrorist attack happened, all of those supply lines were cut off. If you think before a hurricane, people go crazy. That was a very difficult time. And we had people saying, you know what? In terms of vegetables and those kind of foods, we have maybe a week and a half worth to go before we're out. And, you know, certainly right after those planes hit the tower, we had no idea how long we would be isolated. So these things, I'm excited by what you're talking about. That's why people are talking about sustainability now, or if that's an old buzzword now, it's resilience, right? Which is, how is your community able to not just power itself and feed itself and sustain itself, but even survive the kind of, you know, sort of the much more up and down society that we're seeing now. That's why I like the maker movement. That's why I like 3D printers, because that's why I like Etsy, you know. Rather than getting your knit caps from China, you can get it from your neighbor down the street, and you can trade for that the 3D printed piece for their dining room table, and you can make it level again. So I'm excited by that kind of stuff. I agree that getting away from global or being dependent on other places is going to be more and more important versus less and less important. I think we've hit peak globalization. We're starting to think more about being independent that way.
Yeah. And, you know, this is actually going to play out in our lifetimes. There was a generation that could say, oh, well, it's just going to continue forever. But I think at least the millennial generation is starting to see that contraction you mentioned at the end there, where the global system can't go any further. We've pushed it as far as it's going, and it's starting to show cracks and it's contracting. So now there's this rush of sustainability. Well, what can I do that I can continue to do? Or what can I do so that there's not going to be such a shock to the system when I can no longer count on places like China to manufacture cheap goods at the cost of their own environment? In fact, this is another topic that I've got another guest coming in who he's been studying the effects of globalization on China. They become an absolute workhorse economy, a ridiculous powerhouse. But the exchange was they have destroyed huge swaths of their country. And they're now pulling back. They're now looking at places that they can manufacture goods because they don't want to do it at home anymore. And you know, when that starts happening, when those large manufacturing areas start saying, we're not going to do it anymore, it's not worth it, we're selling you something that we want for future generations, maybe it causes people to rethink. And then maybe Hawaii will be the beacon of self-sufficiency.
That's the hope of many people. And I forgot who it was, which billionaire bought the island of Lanai. But he says that he wants to make it the first fully sustainable community. We have a lot of alternative energy research happening here because we have to import our gas, our fuel, our petroleum from both the West Coast of the United States and even from Asia, which makes us very dependent in that way. If we can generate our own power, if we can generate our own food, I'd like to see Hawaii as kind of an example of that kind of independence, because right now, unfortunately, we are kind of an example of that dependence. So we shall see.
We shall see indeed. Ryan Ozawa, thank you so very much for being on Padre's Corner. It's been a blast. We're going to have you back. I'm starting to make panels of people who I'd love to see together. And actually, I want to put you with Robert Stone. He was on the show a while ago. He did a documentary called Pandora's Promise about nuclear power. And I've actually got another expert who talks about renewable energy and the spread of renewable energy. These are all possibilities, but I'd Absolutely. Love to have you back. Could you?
That would be. This is a great honor. I mean, I love hearing Owen J.J. Stone talking about how he hacked the system to get to know everybody and getting on Twitter and stuff. Any opportunity to interact with you and the folks there, I have to come and visit my brick one day. So definitely, I hope that we can stay in touch.
Actually, your brick's in line of sight. I can't quite make it out, but I know where it's located. Could you please tell the Twit Army where they can find you? So, of course, they got to find you on your Twitter page. So that one's easy. Twitter.com/Hawaii. Go yes. for the impossible name, and that's where you're going to find it. But where else can they go if they want to see the work that you've been doing or your blog?
Well, my at Hawaii is, or Hawaii is my favorite username. So you can look for me under that at Instagram, YouTube, Flickr, pretty much most places. I didn't get Hawaii on Snapchat, but other than that, I think I'm pretty well covered. I'd love to connect with you. Otherwise, my blog, hawaiiweblog.com. I've been blogging for 15 years this year, and I actually was publishing online from before that, but I didn't call it a blog. In fact, I hated the word blog and hoped the word blog was going to die an awful death back then, but I've now embraced my blogginess. So Hawaii Weblog is where you can find most of my writing.
Fantastic. Again, thank you for being on. We will have you back soon. Until then, good night to you.
Aloha.
Aloha. Well, folks, that's the end of this episode of Padre's Corner, but you can always find our other episodes, right? We've done a bunch of these, including our beta episodes. All you got to do is go to the show page at twit.tv/Padre. There you'll find our show notes, you'll find our back episodes, and you'll even find a little drop-down menu so that you can get every episode automatically into the device of your choice in the format of your choice. It's one of those things that we do because we love our Twit Army. Also, I'm doing this show live. Yeah, that's right. Every Friday at 5 o'clock Pacific time, you can go to live.twit.tv and see how we do this show. This is a little strange. There's only one other person here on the Twit TV network who TDs his own show, and that's Leo. He's got an office for it. And he inspired me to do something like this. So if you want to see how the sausage is made, jump into live.twit.tv and also jump into our chat room at irc.twit.tv. Don't forget that you can always find me on Twitter. Just go to twitter.com/PadreSJ. And if you follow me there, you'll see what I've been doing on each and every one of my shows, what are future topics, future guests, and you'll find out what I do in between shows. Like, for example, when I crash a fully loaded quadcopter into a tree at 60 miles an hour and essentially turn it into kindling. That's right. I do it out of my love for you. Until next time, I want to thank everyone here who makes the show possible. Of course, to Leo, to Lisa, to all the engineers and all my guests. And of course, to you, chat room, because if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't do this show. I'm Father Robert Ballecer. This has been Padre's Corner. And you've come out sane on the other side.